for the win. Also younger than the sun. Yeah, the bonnie boat was won as we sail into the mystic. I can now hear the sailors cry. Smell the sea and feel the sky. Let your soul and spirit fly into the mystic. And where that foghorn blows, I will be coming home. Yeah, when the foghorn blows, I wanna hear it. I don't have to fear that I wanna rock your gypsy soul. Just like way back in the days of old. Yeah, magnificently we will fold into the mystic. That foghorn, you know I will be coming home. Yeah, when that foghorn whistle blows, I gotta hear it. I don't have to fear it, and I wanna rock your gypsy soul, just like way back in the day. Together we will go into the mystic. Come on, girl.
Thank you. Princess here before you. That's what I said now. Princess, princess who adore you. Just go ahead now. One has diamonds in his pockets, and that's a friend now. This one who wants to buy you rockets, ain't it his head now? Marry him or marry me. I'm the one you're looking at, but can't you see? I ain't got no future up in the tree, but I know what a prince and lover ought to be. I know what a prince and lover ought to be. If you want to call me baby, just go ahead now. And if you like to tell me maybe, just go ahead now. And if you wonder about me flowers, just go ahead now. And if you like to talk for hours, just go ahead now. And if you want to call me baby, just go ahead now. And if you like to tell me maybe, just go ahead now. And if you like to buy me flowers, just go ahead now. And if you like to talk for hours, just go ahead now. If you want to call that maybe, just go ahead now. And if you'd like to tell that maybe, just go ahead now. If you want to buy me flowers, just go ahead now. And if you'd like to talk for hours, just go ahead now.
Something that I'm supposed to be. Something mountain, baby. Ain't no mountain high, ain't no valley low, ain't no river wide enough, baby.
If you need me, call me, no matter where you are, no matter how far.
Don't worry, baby.
Just call my name, I'll be there in a hurry. You don't have to worry, cause baby, there ain't no mountain high enough.
Was one as we sail into the mystic. I can now hear the sailors cry, smell the sea and feel the sky. Let your soul and spirit fly into the mystic. Where that foghorn blows, I will be coming home. Yeah, when the foghorn blows, I wanna hear it. I don't have the fear that I wanna rock your gypsy soul. Just like way back in the days of old, how magnificently we will fold into the mystic. That foghorn, you know I will be coming home. Yeah, when that foghorn whistle blows, I gotta hear it. I don't have the fear that I days of old. And together we will fold into the mystic. Come on, girl.
Just go ahead now. Come on, forget the king. so many songs about rainbows and what's on the other side. Rainbows are visions, but only illusions, and rainbows have nothing to hide. So we've been told, and some choose to believe it. I know they're wrong, wait and see. Someday we'll find it, the rainbow connection, the lovers, the dreamers, and me. Said that every wish would be heard and answered when wished on the morning star. Somebody thought of that, and someone believed it. Look what it's done so far. What's so amazing that keeps us stargazing, and what do we think we might see? Someday we'll find it, the rainbow connection, the lovers, the dreamers, and me. It's something that I'm supposed to be. Someday we'll find it, the rainbow connection, the lovers, the dreamers.
Keep me from getting to you. were born before the wind. Also younger than the sun. Yeah, the bonnie boat was won as we sail into the mystic. I can now hear the sailors cry, smell the sea and feel the sky. Let your soul and spirit fly into the mystic. And where that foghorn blows, I will be coming home. Yeah, when the foghorn blows, I wanna hear it. I don't have to fear that I wanna rock your gypsy soul. Just like way back in the days of old. Yeah, magnificently we will fold into the mystic. That foghorn, you know I will be coming home. Yeah, when that foghorn whistle blows, I gotta hear it. I don't have to fear it, and I wanna rock your gypsy soul, just like way back in the day. Together we will fold into the mystic. Come on, girl.
me before you. That's what I said. Now, princess, princess, who adore you, just go ahead now. One has diamonds in his pockets, and that's a friend now. This one, who wants to buy you rockets, ain't in his head now. Marry him, or marry me, I'm new in the living, but can't you see? I ain't got no future or family tree, but I know what a prince and lover ought to be. I know what a prince and lover ought to be. Want to call me baby, just go ahead now. And if you like to tell me maybe, just go ahead now. And if you wonder about me flowers, just go ahead now. And if you like to talk for hours, just go ahead now. And if you want to call me baby, just go ahead now. And if you like to tell me maybe, just go ahead now. And if you like to buy me flowers, just go ahead now. But if you like to talk for hours, just go ahead now. If you want to call that baby, just go ahead now. And if you'd like to tell that baby, just go ahead now. If you want to buy me flowers, just go ahead now. And if you'd like to talk for hours, just go ahead now.
Something that I'm supposed to be. Something Was one as we sail into the mystic. I can now hear the sailors cry, smell the sea and feel the sky. Let your soul and spirit fly into the mystic. Where that foghorn blows, I will be coming home. Yeah, when the foghorn blows, I wanna hear it. I don't have to fear that I wanna rock your gypsy soul, just like way back in the days of old. How magnificently we will fold into the mystic. Mm-hmm.
that foghorn. You know I will be coming home.
Yeah, when that foghorn whistle blows, I gotta hear it. I don't have to fear it. And I wanna rock on Gypsy's soul, just like way back in the days of old. And together we will go into the mystic. Come on, girl.
Hello, everyone. We want to welcome you to this celebration of Chad's life. As you all know, Chad was very special to all of us. And we're hoping that today we can take this hour in memorial of him. We've assembled people who will all speak about Chad. But first, I wanted to tell you who I am. I'm Glenn Strawn. I was Chad's boss and friend at AED. I'm wearing this shirt in commemoration of that. This is the soccer shirt that I wore many years playing with the AED team. And both Ann and Chad would come watch. And sometimes I was lucky enough to be able to play on the softball team with Chad. So today is a Zoom meeting, and I just want to set some protocols for you. We will allow people who are in the audience to speak. If you could keep your comments to 2 minutes, think of four Jeopardy moments, and then we'll move on to the other person. You will have the ability to raise your hand and we will recognize you. What we do ask is that you, for sure, when you're done talking, go that you mute your phone or your computer. You can turn your camera on so everybody can see you. At 3 o'clock, approximately 3 o'clock, for 30 minutes, we're going to allow everyone to talk and share memories. And it will not be facilitated, or I won't be trying to manage that flow of conversation. So I'd like to get started. And our first person to talk is Anne, his wife.
Hi, everyone. That was a tough last hour and a beautiful one. I'm grateful that you could all, I'm going to read something I wrote because I don't think I'd get through this if I didn't do that. I'm grateful that you could all join me and Chad's family today to mourn Chad as a group, as well as to celebrate his vibrant life. Chad had so many varied and yet interwoven circles of friends, family, and colleagues, and it was challenging to try to represent all of those circles in this memorial. I hope we did him proud. Yeah, I hope you got my message last night. We're wearing hats and t-shirts with slogans and sports logos because Chad loved those things and he wore them, and I've got a ton of his, as you'll see throughout this program. I decided not to change t-shirt mid-program, however. Chad loved baseball stats, pro wrestling, Marvel comic movies, the Godfather movie, but he also loved candles and lots of scents. He officially titled himself the director of scents for our household, and he'd make sure to always have scented candles and air fresheners. And anyone who has been to our home knows that there was always a melange of scents from different scented air fresheners and scented candles. And some people didn't enjoy that as much as Chad. It was fine with me. I have a very poor sense of smell, so that worked out well for us. Throughout this program, we will be lighting candles, I and Chad's sisters, periodically in honor of Chad. There's a poem about lighting candles in honor of a lost loved one that was included in the program. I'll start this by lighting the first one and reading some words from this poem once I find them. The first candle represents our grief. The pain of losing you is intense. It reminds us of the depth of our love for you.
Our next speaker will be Joe Dalliker, who is the brother-in-law of Chad and Ann, and one of their Monday night trivia teammates.
Though we need to weep your loss, you dwell in that safe place in our hearts where no storm or night or pain can reach you. Your love was like the dawn brightening over our lives, awakening beneath the dark of further adventure of color. The sound of your voice found for us a new music that brightened everything. Whatever you enfolded in your gaze quickened in the joy of its being. You place smiles like flowers on the altar of the heart. Your mind always sparkled with wonder at things. Though your days here were brief, your spirit was live, awake, complete. We look towards each other no longer from the old distance of our names. Now you dwell inside the rhythm of breath, as close to us as we are to ourselves. Though we cannot see you with outward eyes, we know our soul's gaze is upon your face, smiling back at us from within everything to which we bring our best refinement. Let us not look for you only in memory, where we would grow lonely without you. You would want us to find you in presence, beside us when beauty brightens, when kindness glows, and music echoes eternal tones. When orchids brighten the earth, darkest winter has turned to spring. May this dark grief flower with hope in every heart that loves you. May you continue to inspire us, to enter each day with a generous heart, to serve the call of courage and love until we see your beautiful face again, in that land where there is no more separation, where all tears will be wiped from our mind, and where we will never lose you again.
Thank you, Joe. I want everyone to realize that we have 196 participants showing up to celebrate Chad. Our next speaker is Quan Luong, who has known Chad since middle school, is a close friend of Chad's, and they went to high school and UVA together.
Hey, thank you, Glenn. Good afternoon, everyone, and thanks so much for being here today. It's with a heavy heart that we come together on the day that Chad would have celebrated his 50th birthday. And though we may not be here to blow out candles and wish him happy birthday, we still gather to celebrate and remember his beautiful and his amazing life. Chad and his family emigrated from the Philippines in 1981 and settled in the DC metro area. They settled in 2838 Marshall Street in Falls Church, Virginia, where Chad's parents still live today. He and I met for the first time in eighth grade at Luther Jackson Middle School. And while our friendship started there, it really blossomed and grew when we both entered Falls Church High School, home of the Jaguars, and the place where 10 boys, including Chad and myself, would find each other and come together to form a long-term bond and friendship. Though not especially creative, we were referred to by our families and friends as the guys, a name and identity that we proudly embraced and that we still invoke today with nostalgia and reverence. The guys represented some of the best and brightest at our high school. I was and have always been proud to be amongst this group. In this amazing group of friends, Chad often stood the tallest among us, and he was, without a doubt, the heart of our group. At an early age, we saw that Chad was just so unique and so interesting. He had an insatiable appetite for information and for data, as well as a passion and interest for so many different things. Chad read everything in high school. He read sports almanacs, encyclopedias. He read English literature, Civil War books. He loved to read comic books and pro wrestling magazines. And he could absorb and retain so much information and call it up and spit it out with such ease. As many of you know, later on in life, Chad would go on to compete on the TV show, the TV game show Jeopardy. And he also became a permanent and formidable fixture on the DC sports bar trivia night circuit. Chad also loved music, and he relished playing the songs that he loved for the people in his life. During high school, the guys, our high school friends, spent so many evenings hanging out in the basement of 2838 Marshall Street, listening to song after song that Chad would play with us, play for us. The soundtrack of my youth is dominated by those memories. And all the beautiful music that Chad exposed me and our friends to. You know, Peaches and Diesel, Wonderful Tonight by Eric Clapton, Moondance and Crazy Love by Van Morrison, More Than a Feeling by Boston, Romeo and Juliet by Dire Straits, and anything from the Big Chill soundtrack, which Chad's sister, Neil, reminded me recently was one of his favorite movies. One of my most distinct memories of this was when Chad wanted to play the song Layla by Derek and the Dominoes for us. Chad said that it was the greatest love song, and he wanted to tell us the story behind the song about how Eric Clapton wrote it to declare his love for Patty Boyd, who at the time was married to his friend and former Beatle, George Harrison. So Chad plays the song for us and we're listening to it. And candidly, I thought, okay, the song's fine, but you know, he had such buildup to it and I just wasn't getting it. And as it seemed like the song was winding down and coming to an end, as I was about to say something, Chad hushed me and the rest of the guys that were there. And he said, hey, the best part is actually coming up. You need to sit there quietly and just listen to it. And as Chad so often did, when he was moved by something, oftentimes because of music, and I'm not gonna do this justice, but Chad would close his eyes, put his arms up and just kind of sway back and forth like this, right? And the next 4 minutes, the 4 minute instrumental ending of the song Layla was the most beautiful thing I'd ever heard at that point in my young life. To this day, without fail, when I hear it, that song, particularly the instrumental ending, still stirs my soul. You know, Chad brought so much beauty to my life and the life of the people around him through music and through so many other ways. He was also a huge movie and sports fanatic. Later in life, as I think most everybody knows, he would amass the most extensive DVD collection. He was absolutely prolific in everything he watched. And he often also read the critical reviews as well as sometimes writing his own critical review. When it came to sports, you know, I could talk about that subject for days. There were very few sports that Chad wasn't interested in, and even less that he couldn't talk extensively about. If you were going to engage Chad in a discussion about movies or sports, I always found two things. One, that you always had to bring your A game with Chad. And two, that you always walked away from that discussion with some sort of interesting and insightful thoughts or comments, because that's who Chad was. In high school, our friends, we all recognized that Chad was just so brilliant. He was gifted with such an amazing brain and a towering intellect. He both wrote and spoke with such eloquence and such a flourish. Academic success in high school came so easy to him. As you guys may have seen, one of the pictures from this slideshow earlier showed Chad and another one of the guys, Ashley, on our high school's It's Academic team. He was an officer in the French Honor Society. He was in the National Honor Society. He was on Model OAS and so forth and so forth. When he graduated from Falls Church High School, he was one of the highest ranked students in our school, and he was accepted to the University of Virginia, where he matriculated in the fall of 1989. I also attended UVA, as Glenn mentioned earlier, and I was lucky enough to join Chad for what I think he felt were four of the most defining and magical years of his life. We both came to UVA excited about this new adventure, but we wondered if, and often doubted that, we would ever find a group of friends as smart and funny and unconventional and irreverent as the guys, our high school friends. But as would be emblematic of Chad's life, his time at UVA was so rich with new and fulfilling experiences and adventures, and more importantly, deep and abiding friendships. From first year Humphrey dorm to the nether region of UVA, also known as Gooch Dillard dorms, to Monroe Hill College and specifically McGuffey dorm, Chad met and befriended so many great men and women who would also become lifelong friends. These friendships were forged in the steam tunnels of UVA, on the ultimate frisbee and softball field, while playing late night card games, while jamming to DJ Chad's music selections in radioactive themed rave dance parties, while hanging out in Chad's dorm room, known as the McGuffey Lounge, and on road trips up and down the East Coast. At UVA, Chad also continued to pursue his interests and his passions. He joined the University Journal, one of our college newspapers, and became a sports writer, combining two of the things that he really loved, writing and sports. He was so good at it and he was so passionate about it. But probably his greatest journalistic work wasn't the University Journal. It was probably on a lesser known and less official publication known as the McGuffey Mag, right? This was a weekly tabloid magazine that Chad took upon himself to start that was dedicated to reporting some news, but largely gossip and half-truths about the residents of McGuffey Dorm. It was largely a one-man operation. He had guest writers at times, but in which Chad handled everything. He handled the investigations. He handled the speculation, maybe sometimes fabrication. And he ultimately handled the publication. This weekly rag of fake news, right, was about 25 years ahead of its time. It brought so much joy and sometimes a little angst to the residents of McGuffey Dorm and Chad's circle of friends. Chad was just so much fun, and this was just one of the many ways in which he spiced up the lives of the people around him. Chad loved his time at UVA and the friendships and memories that he formed there. I believe that his experience informed or affirmed the way he viewed life and how to treat the people in his life. After college, Chad moved into the field of computers and information technology and had a long and successful career, working at companies like AED, JSI, Fairchild Dornier, and MFA. He and I never talked much about the details of our jobs because with Chad, there was just so many other interesting things to discuss, but I know that he enjoyed his work, and I know that he loved the people he worked with at those different places. Like high school and college, Chad made so many lifelong friends along every step of his journey. To me, Chad was a man in full. His life overflowed with music and movies and sports and trivia and wackiness and adventure and irreverence and just so much laughter. He was so interested and engaged in life and all of its offerings. People often talk about the credo of living your life to the fullest, but Chad was one of the few that actually did it. And while this approach and these attributes made him so interesting and so fun and so one of a kind, I don't think this is what defined him, nor what was most important to him. To me, and I know to so many of our friends, what made Chad so special was simply how good and decent of a man he was, and how much he loved and valued all the people in his life. I was lucky enough to be in Chad's life for over 35 years, and I got to see him with so many different groups and so many different settings and at so many different times. He was always so proud of each and every group of friends. In college, he talked about the guys and our high school exploits constantly. He would often end a conversation with me by leaning across and saying to me, "Hey, Quan, viva la guys," or "the guys number 10, his way of affirming our friendship. When we came home from college for a break, he would talk with the guys about our college friends and about the adventures at UVA. He had the same love and pride in that group of friends that he showed in the guys when he was at UVA. When he graduated from college, Chad talked so much about the exploits and the adventures of the AED friends and the JSI friends. He just loved so much all of the different circles of friends in his life. He loved people. He loved his wife. He loved his family. He loved his friends. He loved bringing together friends, whether it was people within a circle or different circles of friends. Whether it was a Super Bowl party or poker night or movie night, everyone was welcomed and everyone was loved. We can't celebrate Chad's life without mentioning his parents and his sisters. Mr. and Mrs. Capule, Angie, Neil, we are so sorry for your loss. But we thank you for raising such a good man. We thank you for always opening up your home and your hearts to Chad's friends and allowing us to grow and strengthen our friendship with him and with each other. And finally, the woman that came along in Chad's life and whose love filled in the final slot that existed in a nearly full, but nevertheless still slightly incomplete life. Anne has said to me a number of times these past few months that she was so lucky to have found Chad, that she was just so happy, that she knows what she had with him. I don't disagree that Chad was one of the good ones, but I am so thankful, Anne, that Chad found you and for the love and happiness that you brought to his life. I know you know this, but he loved you so much, he knew how lucky he was to have you, his beloved Anne. Chad's life shined so brightly, and he touched and made more beautiful every life that he came into contact with. He lived his life with no ego or pretension. He was comfortable in his own skin, and to borrow some words from our college friend John Wilson, he loved intensely the people in his life. Losing Chad has been tough, and I know that many of us are still struggling with this and trying to figure out when this grief will subside and when the emptiness in our hearts will feel full again. But one of the many things that Chad taught me in the way he conducted his own life is to live as best as you can with unfettered joy and unwavering optimism. So keeping that in mind, I am thankful for the time that we all had with him and for all the wonderful memories that he gave to us. Going forward, I will carry Chad and those memories in my heart, and I will love him forever. Chad may be gone from our lives, but I believe as long as we always remember him and celebrate him and hold him close to our hearts, he will always, always be with us. Thank you.
Thank you, Kwong. Next will be Melina Skoto-Maston, who has known Chad since 2004. Chad was her supervisor, IT mentor, and kindness guru. He always inspired Melina to go for it professionally and personally. She hopes he is looking down from heaven, thinking, "So fetch."
Oh,
Lighting candle number two is Chad's sister, Angie Fontanilla.
Hello, everyone, and thank you for being here, to friends and family. Next to me is a part of Chad here. Thank you, Anne, for sharing him. Also, this is his favorite Yankee Candle scent, one of them, lavender vanilla. I think he might have given this to me, actually. The second candle represents our courage to confront our sorrow, to comfort each other, to change our lives.
Thank you, Angie. Now we will have a number of speakers. Our first is Rich Clark, who is Chad's close friend from high school.
Hello, everyone. Thank you for coming. I thought about what to say, and I've been reflecting on that. And I thought about what Chad meant to me and who he was to me and to the guys. So I'm a member of that infamous group of high school misfits. Chad was an unusual person, very just easy to underestimate, but just kind of drew you in with who he was and his loyalty, his enthusiasm, his incredible intellect and wit, and we all became friends. And I was reflecting on his unbridled enthusiasm whenever he talked about us, and whenever we saw him, and whenever I returned and made sure I saw him. And I think I figured out that for each other and for Chad, we were all the brothers that you chose. He chose us as his brothers, and we chose him as our brother. I was thinking about this one time. Me, Chad, and Quan were in a hotel room, just getting ready for Dan's wedding. And Chad, he ironed his suit and he ironed his clothes, and then he went in to go take a shower. And as soon as the water was running, Quan jumped up and re-ironed his clothes for him. I was like, dude, what are you doing? And he was like, look, I just want to make sure he looks good. And that moment was when I realized that we're taking care of each other. Quan was taking care of Chad. Chad takes care of us. And we took care of each other as family, as brothers. We laughed together. We cried together. We've lied together. And these are my brothers, and we are his brother, and always will be. And there is always a place for him in our hearts that will be a little bit missing for our brother. And for him, I say, Chad, we will miss you. Thank you.
Next will be John Wilson, who was a college friend of Chad's at UVA and in the infamous McGuffey Hall dorm, as I now understand. Chad was one of John's groomsmen, local DC area friend, and frequent vacationing companion over the past 25 years to New York, the Outer Banks, San Francisco, Florida, and Los Angeles.
Thank you, Glenn. Many have spoken and many will speak of Chad's talent and love for trivia. I gladly acknowledge that he was a master, but I must confess my brain is not a trivia brain. I'm lucky if I can remember the names of my children. And my love for and bonding with Chad had little to do with trivia games or trivia nights. Instead, I will follow in Quan's highlighting of Chad's amazing writing ability. I myself enjoy writing and I'm not so horrible at it, but for me, it's work. Chad was maddening in that writing for him was effortless. We both worked at one of UVA's student newspapers, and whereas I was edit, re-edit, and wordsmith an article for days, Chad would forget all about his assignment until an hour before it was due, and then blast out a brilliant, witty piece, always containing at least one Homeric reference. In 1992, Chad and I wrote a head-to-head on Streaking the Lawn, which technically isn't a sports piece, but he was able to kind of, you know, make that leap. And I'll read now a few paragraphs he wrote from the original. Let's see if I can get it there for a second. The Lawn, perhaps one of the most beautiful works of divine creation ever to behold with thine eyes, a marvel worthy of being one of the seven wonders of the modern world. The Lawn, inviolable and sacrosanct, the symbol of the majesty and glory that is Thomas Jefferson and the University of Virginia. The Lawn, lush, green, redolent with sweet fragrances. Naked. What was that you said? Naked as a jaybird. That's right. One unholy April evening, as I sat on the steps of the rotunda, three heathens committed the unthinkable, a transgression so vile and puerile that it mocks the very essence of nobility, the very honor of this great university. Hey, man, check them out. They're streaking the lawn. Words failed to escape me as I watched in horror at what was unraveling before my eyes. Three reprobates, daring to call themselves civilized folk, proceeded to disrobe with much zeal as they prepared to make the unholy trek. With much contumacy, these inebriated felons fled into the darkness like wild beasts, ranting and raving as they flashed down the ivory steps of the rotunda. Needless to say, those who gathered to witness the event allowed mob rule to prevail. They cheered, they clapped, they unleashed tasteless roars of approval. I was quiet. I withheld my opprobrium until this moment. And so on and so on. He was a genius. Chad wrote equally brilliant and witty newsletters, as Quan has noted, for our UVA dorm and called it the McGuffey Mag. Sometimes it was called the Rag. It detailed the limited gossip and scandal that we were able to produce and did so in a manner that was both clever and, let's be honest, deliberately needling of its readers. It was clear with every edition that Chad wrote in his clever, needling way. He was listening to us. He was interested in us and he was loving us. And he did not just write for his UVA friends, but continued his loving newsletters at AED and perhaps beyond. One of the many things I will miss about Chad is very much related to his writing for us. What I'll miss is how he was so central to our McGuffeyite identities, both at UVA and especially post-UVA. His hubness is easily explained while we were at UVA when he was busy entertaining us with the McGuffey Mag, making the dorm room the McGuffey Hangout, pirating cable with the aid of Craig and John Muskoff, and hosting radioactive dance raves. What mystified me as I mulled his legacy was how he continued to be the hub of our McGuffey crowd and served as the hub of probably every social circle he ever encountered. It was not because he was spamming us with emails or blowing up our phones or continuing to write weekly mags. And while he was generous with hosting get-togethers, McGuffey nights, and Super Bowl parties, we were all also busy with our schooling, our careers, our children, etc. So how did Chad remain so central to us? I was stumped for a bit and only solved this puzzle, at least in my thinking, after a few clues popped into my grieving mind these past few months. The first seemed random. Among his favorite movies were the Godfather series, as long as you ignore the third movie. What he loved about The Godfather, I believe, was the tight, loyal sense of family that permeates the films. But that's just trivia. It doesn't explain Chad's hubness. The second clue popped up as a result of my numerous calls, texts, and emails with Chad's sisters, Angie and Neil, while Chad was in the ICU. Chad would talk about his sisters from time to time, and over 30 years, that adds up. The one time I saw Chad truly angry, it was because he felt someone had done wrong to one of his sisters. That memory reminded me of all the other times Chad had talked about Angie and Neil, and it suddenly dawned on me that Chad loved Angie and Neil intensely and was fiercely loyal to them. And we all saw that same intense love and fierce loyalty when Chad married the love of his life, Anne. And suddenly the mystery of Chad's hubness, the centrality he had in all our lives as fellow McGuffeyites, became clear to me. Chad saw all of us as family, and he loved each of us intensely and was fiercely loyal to every one of us. And that's a pretty amazing gift, and I'm going to miss the giver. Thank you.
Thank you, John. Next is Jen Lukowitz, who has been Chad's friend since they worked together at AED, and they were also housemates for several years.
Thanks, Glenn. I met Chad in 1997. When I first moved to the area, we worked at AED together. And like Glenn said, we were also roommates for several years. I think the fact that as I look out now and I see so many people that I not only recognize but count among my own close friends really is just a testament to how Chad really brought people together. For those of us that worked at AED, I think we all thought he was the glue of AED, but he did that everywhere. He did it with the guys who I was fortunate enough to meet through him. He did it at the different companies he worked with. He did it with the trivia community. Chad really was like a magnet that drew people to him. But more importantly, he really did get great joy from bringing people together. So many people have mentioned his epic Super Bowl parties. So Chad and I were roommates for a while, and it was really during that time that he became like a brother to me. And I think like with all siblings, I had so much love for him, but we also drove each other nuts. He would sneak out after I fell asleep to crank up the air conditioning, and I would have to sneak out afterwards and turn it back down. My parents, who are out here today, will remember the time that he swore that the Christmas tree he had stood in our living room was perfectly straight until the day it finally tilted so far that it came crashing down. But besides being like a brother to me, Chad really was a part of my family. Some of you know when 9/11 happened, Chad was getting ready to fly back to DC from Newark Airport, and he got stranded there. So he called me, I guess, because I'm from New Jersey, and he thought I might know what to do. And he somehow managed to get a taxi at the airport, and he took it an hour and a half to my parents' house, who lived in South Jersey. And he stayed there for the next few days until he was able to get back to DC. And you know, when it first happened, I felt like my parents were coming to his rescue. You know, he was stranded, he was stuck up there alone. Afterwards, though, I realized in typical Chad fashion, he was actually the one taking care of them. You know, he watched the news with them. He talked to my mom about what was happening and what was going on. He kept them calm while everything was going crazy. And I think that's when Chad really, truly became a member of my family. When I think about Chad now, I am so sad about how early he was taken from us. But I take comfort from one thing, and that is that he was able to spend the last years of his life with the love of his life, Anne. Rich likes to tell a story about how one day Chad had arranged for a group of us to go wine tasting, as he would do. We were driving home and Rich and I were in the back seat. Anne was up in the passenger seat and Chad was driving. And Chad was being his, you know, usual chatty self. Me and Rich were in the back and we were full of wine and we were tired and we were grumpy. But Chad was playing different music and telling jokes and talking. And Anne looked so happy. And she was smiling right along with him and laughing right along with him. And I whispered to Rich that day that you could tell that they were meant to be together. And it wasn't long after that that they were married. And so now I just take peace from the fact that Chad lived life exactly the way he deserved, surrounded by wonderful family, so many friends, and Anne, who loved him exactly the way he was. Cheers, buddy. We love you and miss you.
Thank you, Jen. Our next tribute comes from Paul Crystal. Paul met Chad a little more than 15 years ago when Chad worked at JSI. The way Paul describes it, their friendship since that time was built on disagreeing over nearly everything. They rooted hard against each other's favorite baseball teams, never ever bet on the same jockey during yearly trips to the horse track, debated vigorously on what the elements of a truly funny trivia name were, and definitely held very different opinions about the virtues of 80s pop music and science fiction. As you'll hear from him now, Paul relished and was thankful for every moment of it.
No doubt, Chad had some really big moments in his life. But what I appreciated most in him was the way he enjoyed the continuous small moments. He didn't just include us. He made us feel like everything was that much better for him because we were there too. In the past 3 months, I can't tell you the number of times I've suddenly wanted to call Chad to test him on some obscure fact that I had just learned, or tell him I'd heard somebody severely misquote one of his favorite movies, one of those movies that he'd freely lend out from his large collection of DVDs. And it's an awful jolt each time I suddenly realize I can't. Perhaps that's the hardest part of losing a friend like Chad, just not being able to talk anymore. When Ann invited me to sing at today's memorial, I wanted very much to return the privilege by finding a song that honors both Chad and her. One that recognizes that despite the dreadful way coronavirus has pulled people away from each other, Chad and Ann fought his illness with the oneness I always knew them for. And when the time came to stop the fight, they stopped it together. I would like to sing a few stanzas of Shelter from the Storm by Bob Dylan. And I do so with the intense hope that we will all find some measure of peace in our sadness today. Was in another lifetime, one of toil and blood, when blackness was a virtue and the road was full of mud. I came in from the wilderness, a creature void of form. Come in, she said, I'll give you shelter from the storm. If I pass this way again, you can rest assured I'll always do my best for her. On this I give my word. The world of Eli, death and men who are fighting to be warm. Come in, she said, I'll give you shelter from the storm. Exhaustion, I was buried in the hail, poisoned in the bushes, and hunted on the trail, hunted like a crocodile, ravaged in the corn. Come in, she said, I'll give you shelter from the storm. Thank you. Suddenly I turned around, she was standing there with silver bracelets on her wrist and flowers in her hair. She walked up to me so gracefully and she took my crown of thorns. Come in, she said, I'll give you shelter from the storm. Come in, she said, I'll give you shelter from the storm.
Thank you, Paul. That was amazing. Lighting candle number three will be Neil Capule, Chad's sister.
Hello, everyone. So I have the scented candle. It's a eucalyptus mint, two of his favorite things. But I do want to add something that he loves, and I really hate it when I'm in his car. A car scent. Because he loves that. Okay, technical difficulty, sorry. Okay. This third candle we light in your memory for the times we laughed, the times we cried, the times we were angry with each other, the silly things you did, the caring and joy you gave us.
Our next speaker will be Dave Schneier, who's been a very long-term friend of Chad from his days at AED. Thank you.
Thanks, Glenn. Chad was my first real friend at my first real job in DC. It was at the Academy for Educational Development, and I worked with his sister, Angie. So one day he stopped by my desk and invited me to a happy hour. And that was really the beginning of a great friendship. Later on, he was the manager of the softball team, and he made what many believe was the smartest managerial move ever. He put me in center field and put this woman, Jen, in right field. After many games and many happy hours at the Dancing Crab, Jen and I started dating, and we've now been together for over 20 years. All thanks to the manager of the year, Chad Capule. So I'm not telling anyone anything new by saying that he was one of the greatest people and friends I knew, but here's just one example that not many people know. Chad and I had been to a house party in Virginia, and he drove me back to the East Falls Church Metro, dropped me off after the party. So I got to the turnstiles and quickly realized that the Metro was closed. At this point, Chad was basically home, but I called him anyway. Hey, Chad, any chance you could pick me back up? Now, I figured he could either say no, or maybe I'd crash at his place or he'd find a cab nearby for me. But Chad drove me the whole way home. From the East Falls Church Metro in Virginia to the Shady Grove Metro in Maryland. He then drove back home without blinking or complaining. I'm not sure how many people would do something like that. And that's just the tip of the iceberg with him. From concerts and happy hours to trivia nights and trips to the Outer Banks and every computer issue or question I had, and there were a lot of them, it was Chad. He was always there. Jen and I were proud to ask him to be our son's godfather, because what better role model for our son than Chad? I miss him every day, and I learned a whole lot about him and his character in our time as friends. I hope we could all be more like him, because if this world were full of Chads, we'd all be a lot better off. Thank you.
Thank you, Dave. Our next speaker is Praveen Todeja. He worked with Chad for 14 years, first at GW, then at CITI. He was a good friend and a mentor.
Thank you, Glenn. Good afternoon, friends. I'm Praveen Todeja. I'm honored to be here amongst all of you, remembering and celebrating our dear friend, Chad Capule, such an amazing person. It's been my privilege to be part of Chad's life for the past 14 years. I met him first at GW and I hired him in 2006. For me, Chad was never just an employee, neither at GW nor at CITI. Chad was a cherished colleague, someone I enjoyed working with, someone I depended on. He worked hard, kept everyone in check, never said anything against anybody, always saw the good in people. He was always optimistic about everything in life. I got compliments about his work, his ethics, his dedication, and his persistence to solve problems. I got calls, emails. I also got stopped in hallways while running to a meeting, telling me how good he was. Three things that make me smile about his work ethics. Number one, we all know he was a hard worker, and he was always available to work 24/7, except when it was trivia night, whether it was Monday or Tuesday. In fact, I remember we had to push a goal line because it was trivia night. Number two, he was very hyper. Always, as soon as the task was given, he would either work on it or assign it to somebody. And if you were assigned the task and you did not respond, he will hound you daily until you got it done. I know many of my staff right now will be nodding their head. Number three, Chad was the only person who I know was so organized that his inbox at the end of the day had zero emails. I don't know anyone else who can say that about their inbox. Chad was a scholar. I mean, the guy was a walking encyclopedia, and yet always so humble. I was fortunate enough to be alongside with him and share his experience at Jeopardy in LA. What an amazing day for Chad. Chad was a man you couldn't help but admire. Admire his passion for life, his love for his wife, his compassion for his cats, and his admiration for the finer things in life, such as good music, good movie, good shows, good wine, a whole lot of trivia, and most importantly, his good friends. By the show of the people on the call today, we know he had a lot of friends. And everywhere he went, he created friends. He had friends from CITI, from MFA, GSI, EAD, trivia friends, UVA friends, high school friends, everywhere. Every partner or customer site that he would go, he would create a lot more friends. They all loved him. In fact, many of them are on the call today. Chad had an amazing personality. He took the time to keep up with everyone in his life. I don't know how he did that. For me, Chad was more than a friend. He was my brother. He's someone I will never forget. He taught me a lot more than one can imagine. And I know all of us had a different bond with Chad, but one thing we can all agree on is that we are all better people after being around Chad. If I can sum it up in one sentence, Chad was such a great soul that even God wanted to be close to him and call him early to heaven. Even the program says that Chad lived to be 49, but for me, he will live forever. We'll miss you, Chad. Thank you.
Thank you, Praveen. Our next speaker is Mandy Loy, a longtime friend of Chad and a doormate of his at UVA.
Thank you, Glenn. Thank you, everyone, for being here today. Ann and I discussed in the days leading up to today how any words that we came up with to talk about Chad would fall short, but I'd like to try and explain what he meant to me. I met Chad for the first time almost 31 years ago in college. Like so many others have said today, he became like a brother to me. And over the decades, I met countless people, sure many of you hearing me now who felt the same way about him. Beyond his generally cheerful and welcoming nature, he was incredibly generous with his time. Instead of spending one weekend a month in the Army Reserves, there was a period when I think he must have spent at least one weekend a month helping a friend move. In addition to his sense of mischief and fun, devotion to friends, family, pets, and his beloved Anne, dedication to his work and coworkers, and passion for history, literature, trivia and games, sports, the outdoors, movies and music. I believe Chad was a sucker for a powerful moment, especially in movies, music, and sports. Moments like Sonny Corleone's death in a hail of bullets in The Godfather, the conclusion to the song Layla, as Quan mentioned, by Derek and the Dominoes, which punctuates another mafia film Chad loved, Goodfellas. When our dear old UVA won its first men's basketball national championship last year, or when Daenerys Targaryen emerges from the ashes of an inferno with her newly hatched dragons on Game of Thrones. The poem to follow, Funeral Blues by W.H. Auden, creates a heart-wrenching scene in the film Four Weddings and a Funeral. For Chad's sake, I'm tempted to read it in a thick Scottish brogue as actor John Hannah did in the movie, but I'll abstain. Stop all the clocks. Cut off the telephone. Prevent the dog from barking with the juicy bone. Silence the pianos and with muffled drum. Bring out the coffin. Let the mourners come. Let aeroplanes circle moaning overhead. Scribbling on the sky the message, he is dead. Put crepe bows round the white necks of the public doves. Let the traffic policemen wear black cotton gloves. He was my north, my south, my east and west, my working week and my Sunday rest, my noon, my midnight, my talk, my song. I thought that love would last forever. I was wrong. The stars are not wanted now. Put out everyone. Pack up the moon and dismantle the sun. Pour away the ocean and sweep up the wood. For nothing now can ever come to any good. It's a powerful outpouring of feeling. These words touch us, but don't let them be the coda to the life of a truly special human being. Today is a celebration of that life, and we can cherish forever the time we had with him, however brief it may have been. To end on an optimistic note, and with a movie reference, both of which I think Chad would appreciate, I'll quote William Goldman from The Princess Bride. Death cannot stop true love. All it can do is delay it for a while. With love for Chad and all those who mourn him, and gratitude for having known him, I say thank you.
Oh boy, okay. So we will now go back to Anne, who will be lighting candle number 4.
Sorry for that delay. Oof. Mandy, I knew that was going to be a killer. Candle 4. The fourth candle we light for our love. We light this candle that your light will always shine as we think of you each day and share your memory with our family and friends. We cherish the special place in our hearts that will always be reserved for you. We thank you for the gift of your living brought to each of us. We love you. We remember you. This candle is scented fireside.
At this time, we're going to try to make this work in the Zoom environment. Just so you know, the person who's been working with me is named Shanti Geigen, and she, I hope, can control turning on the microphone for anyone who raises their hand and wishes to say a few words about Chad. Please don't take more than 1 to 2 minutes to do so. And also, please let us know who you are when you come on. And turn your phone off, muted after you're done. So Shantae, can you make it happen?
Yes. I just need whoever wants to speak to raise their hand. Howard?
Wow, that was quick. I didn't know it was going to be the first one. Is this working?
Yes.
Yes.
Okay, cool. I don't know if I can be seen video-wise. It's a little dark. My name is Howard. I run Trivia Kings. We, at least one of the things that Chad and his friends and family were participating in, I just thought I had to say something, and it's not well prepared, so I apologize. But I guess I've had the privilege of knowing Chad for roughly a decade, and it just has to be said that he's been one of the most loyal and fiercest competitors we've had across the DC, Maryland, Virginia area. And this all is just very sad in general for so many reasons, but just a couple of things about Chad. It's just funny that I didn't really have the chance to appreciate Chad for what he meant to us fully. I am grateful though that the last time I saw Chad, I was able to personally thank him, because he, like I said, for pretty much a decade, he has been arguably the most loyal competitor person participating we've had. And I've got to know him, I mean, not as well as I'd like to, but you can't go 10 years without interactions. I told him personally how much I appreciated his loyalty and how much he helped us. For those of you that didn't know, it wasn't just Monday and Tuesday things. He bounced around, and I was just amazed how I could see him in Virginia and then in DC and all the way in Maryland. And I didn't know like how he was doing it. And whenever I saw him, it was a plus and minus, because I was so thankful that he was there to help participate. But also I was like, oh man, Chad's gonna win again. He's so good. But as good as he was, I felt bad, because we have our like an annual championship type thing. And I always thought to myself, man, I wish Chad would win, because I couldn't think of anyone more, a nicer guy that was more deserving to do that. And one thing I just wanted to know, if we somehow managed to come back and still have this in 2021, I wanted to have a namesake for our annual trophy, and I just wanted to put that in his honor. So that way, if he never won it, but at least his name will be on it as a memorial, and just as a symbol of everyone participating and how much he meant, and just as a symbol to us and to others who maybe want to strive to just achieve that level. So, it's really rough, but I don't know, Anne, if you can hear me, if you don't mind, I just wanted to, have it be the Chad trophy that people win. So his memory is always with us, and people learn about him who may not have never even met him. So that's all I have to say about that. Thank you very much. And I'm so sorry for everything with your loss, but his memory will go on if I can do anything to help that. Thank you.
Thank you, Howard. We have 6 people with their raised hands, but Howard, I wanted to let you know you can't see Anne, or maybe you did. She had her thumbs up. So Shantae, can you call the next person?
Bobby.
Hi, my name is Bobby Koo. I met Chad first year at UVA, Humphrey's dorm, second left. He had the room next to me. He was sharing with Kwan at the time. And we just became fast friends, all of us in that hallway. And, you know, we settled on this crazy blue light special routine of going to the meals at the observatory dining facility at like 4:30, 5 o'clock in the afternoon, really, just to beat the crowds. But, you know, for us, I think it was a great social time to eat together, talk about our day, and you know, just joke around and learn about each other. And I think the other speakers have really captured a lot of what I remember about Chad, the irreverence, the great humor, the intellect, the trivia. What I remember about Chad is that he had such enthusiasm for life, and once he made up his mind, he was full out committed to it. And, you know, when other people might be waffling, you know, do we want to play another round of cards? Do we want to go on this road trip? Do we want to do whatever it was? But once Chad made up his mind, he was all in, and it was hard not to not for that enthusiasm to be contagious. So really enjoyed knowing him for the college years. And it was easy because I also lived in Northern Virginia during my college years, but after college moved down to North Carolina. So kind of drifted apart, but it was amazing that, you know, Chad in his way wanted to come and visit and make that connection again. And I think it's just a testament to who he was and how he lived. Thank you.
Thank you, Bobby. Shantae, can you select the next person?
Kristen.
My name is Kristen Post. Thanks for going to me. I'm a member of the Rotary Club of DuPont Circle, and I've known Chad for 8 years. Rotary, if you don't know, is a service organization. It's a global organization. And we, our clubs often do local and global service projects around the world. And Leanne and Will are friends with Chad. And when our club was first starting up, we wanted to figure out what a good fundraiser would be, because Rotary clubs raise money and then they give their money to these projects. And Leanne suggested we do trivia night, and invited Chad to be our trivia master. And for 8 years, he and Ann were sort of the lifeblood of our signature fundraiser. And we were able to build a bridge in Zimbabwe and do a lot more with the money that we raised from these events. I was the charter president, so I was the president when he and Ann did their first fundraiser, the first trivia night, which was at the Beer Baron. And then I happened to be the fundraising committee chair, so I was running the event that was our last event, which was just in April, just before they left for Wisconsin. And Chad and I met because we were at a new venue and we were trying to see what the space was like. And we talked to, you know, the manager about the availability of a microphone, and he and I met on a rainy, cold night, and we were both starving. And so one of my last memories of him is stuffing deviled eggs into our face after meeting with him, because we were both so starving. As usual, he ran an amazing fundraiser. It was our best attended trivia night. In his honor this year, we wanted to, and Anne's, we wanted to do something on the district level. District 7620 is our district and includes Maryland and DC. So I can't show you, but I have a Service Above Self Award presented to Chad Capule for exemplifying principles and ideals of our Rotary heritage for 8 years of outstanding trivia fundraising assistance. And then we have an honorary club membership to present to Anne. Europe, an honorary member of the Rotary Club of DuPont Circle, and know that we appreciate everything that you did and Chad did, and you're always welcome to be part of our Rotary family whenever you want to. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Kristen. Shante, can you slow the person?
Gail. Gail, it is not allowing Gail to talk at this moment. Let's come back to Gail.
Okay.
James.
James Finn. James, you're on.
You must have chaos within you to give birth to a dancing star. Hi, my name is James Finn. I worked with Chad Capule at JSI and at the MFA. And one of the things that I was always just blown away by was Chad's ability to just take the chaos and just make energy out of it and just use energy to just solve a problem and just leave everybody happy at the end of it. It was just, it's a skill I've never seen anyone able to do. And I just wanted to point that out. That's all.
Thank you, James. Shante, is there another person?
Amy
from AED.
Hi there. I met Chad when I was a new employee at AED in 1996, when he set up my 386 computer with Netscape and Lotus 1-2-3 on it. And he was so friendly, welcoming, and enthusiastic. And at the time, it just blew my mind. With all of his computer knowledge in the era when I still had dial-up in my house. And Chad was so sociable. And I think one reason he loved his job at AED was it was a way to recruit employees to join the AED softball team for the International Development League. Along with Dave Schneier, and I just had so much fun during those times playing softball. And I met so many other amazing people, all because of Chad. And in 1998, I got very sick. And I had to leave AED to return to my hometown in Pittsburgh, PA, to enter the hospital to wait for a life-saving heart transplant. And I had to stay in the hospital for over 8 months, but it turned out over that year that under Chad's leadership, AED had won the softball league tournament. And he and Dave drove from DC to visit me in the hospital with the trophy that they had won for AED. And it meant so much to me. And it was just another example of how selfless, caring, empathetic, and giving he was. And
And I just wanted to add, I'm really glad that he ended up with Anne, the amazing woman that he deserved. And just one other thing I could ramble on, but Glenn, Anne, Quan, Angie, Jen, Dave, Mandy, and Bridget O'Keefe. I don't know if you even remember me, but I know a lot about you because Chad always talked about you and just all the important people in his lives and in his life and how much the people in his life really meant to him. And that's all I just wanted to say. Thank you.
Thank you, Amy. Shante, can you, we'll take two more people.
Leah, I guess. He's...
Hi. Yeah. All right. So Chad was a lot of things to a lot of people. To me, he was my uncle. He and my Aunt Anne they complemented each other very well. And like, I knew him as an individual, but I think another way in which I knew him was the connection that he shared with my Aunt Anne. I guess how I remember him is he was a very fun person. He loved games. Every time that he and Aunt Anne, came for holidays, they'd always have tons of games. He would always have, we'd go to see movies together. And I remember geeking out with him about stuff like Star Wars. He knew tons of stuff about pop culture. And you know, that was, I like that. And I've stayed with him and my Aunt Anne a few times. And I remember he always, they always, we went out to a lot of fun places. We went out to a lot of really, really tasty Asian restaurants. I do remember that. One of the, probably the last memory that I have of him is, this was around Christmas when we went to the movies. We went to see Star Wars Episode 9, and I sat next to him. And, that memory echoes a lot more in my mind now than I ever thought it would. And he was a welcome member of the family. I think he brought a lot of life and energy and joy whenever I was around him, whenever he was part of stuff. And he and my Aunt Anne brought out the best in each other. They complemented each other so well. And something else I remember is their all-time favorite movie together was the movie Hot Fuzz. It was half action movie, half British tea cozy mystery. And I think that represents the bond that he and my Aunt Anne shared. So he was a wonderful man, a good uncle. And he will be missed.
Thank you, Leah, for those words. Shante, do you have another person? Nathaniel.
Thanks, Leah. I did not have the pleasure to know Chad as long as most of you, but like Leah, I did have the joy to call him my uncle. Something that was so special to me, and I'm sure everyone knew, was how much fun and joy he brought to any event. For me, my brother, our family, that was the holidays. We always had a good time as a family on Thanksgiving and Christmas, but when Uncle Chad entered our lives, that became the best time. Whether it was poker, Risk, Secret Hitler, marrying Mr. Darcy, just sitting around talking. Uncle Chad's presence made our lives and our family better. and I'll miss him so much, both as an uncle and a role model. And yeah, he's loved and he will be missed. And my condolences to everyone. Thank you.
Thank you, Nathaniel. Shantae, can we have one more person?
Ashley.
Hi, everybody. My name's Ashley Strand, and I'm one of the guys. And I want to tell a quick story, if I can, about the only cold thing Chad ever said to me. We all know he's a very warm person, and in fact, he could get very heated. One of the great things about being friends with Chad as a lifelong hothead is that we could have very passionate arguments and still be great friends at the end of the day. But when I got to high school, I had one talent, which was the ability to piss just about anybody off in record time. And I had no capacity to make friends. And I knew one person in high school who I'd gone to junior high with, and that was Jamie Leisure. And Jamie, I'm going to call you out. He was trying to ditch me. But I couldn't bear to sit alone in the lunchroom. So I followed Jamie to the table where he was, and he'd already made a group of friends who turned out to be the guys. There was a space next to Chad, and I think word had spread about me already somehow on the very first day, because I said to him, can I sit here? And he said, do what you want. So I sat down and desperately tried to insert myself into the conversation, and just saying whatever dumb things came to my head. And Chad turned to me at some point and said, are you just going to sit there saying, are you just going to sit there making ridiculous statements until someone pays attention to you? And Rich Clark laughed. And although I hadn't technically gotten the laugh, at that point I had been involved in a laugh. And Chad, God bless him, saw my value to the group at that point and sort of gave me my identity. You know, I was the guy who would just always say the most outrageous things. And, you know, he was the guy who would process it and say, that's a great idea, or that's the worst idea ever. And we would get into long discussions about that, you know. But after that moment, I belonged. And I don't think I would have survived high school if it hadn't been for that group of guys. And probably everyone in that group wanted to eject me at some point. But like Quan said, you know, he was the glue. And like everyone has said, he's so loyal. And he found the interest in everybody. Made everyone feel like they belonged. And made everyone appreciate themselves in the reflection of his appreciation. I probably wouldn't be friends with all those guys still if it weren't for Chad. And he's just been so important in my life. And as sad as it is that he's gone, I think he's left us all with a great gift of an example of a life well lived. And I just want to send my love to the Capules and to Anne, and sending my prayers to everyone. Thank you.
Thank you. We have Gail McGinnis.
Thank you so much for making this happen, Glenn. I appreciate it. I will keep it brief. He was a huge part of my adult life. I met him at AED, which was my first job. And then he's been just a really steadfast friend for my whole adult life. I think he may be the only person that's seen all the different apartments I've lived at over the last 25 years, literally, like including family and other friends. I think he may have been one of the people that helped me move several of those times. he's been there for the ups and the downs and the moves, the new jobs, new relationships, and heartbreaks. So many of my memories include him. So I wanted to say that and just also touch on, as so many people have, his love for Anne. I think I might have been the recipient of the last text he sent in his life. He somehow sent a text from the ICU when he was on a ventilator. And what it said was, if you can, please support Anne. She needs love. And I think that really sums it up. He was thinking of her as he lay there. So I loved him, and I'll really miss him. And thanks for the opportunity.
Thank you, Gail. Shante, I believe there's one more person. Asif. I definitely know Asif.
I met Chad. I met Chad and Anne around the same time, about 22 years ago, when I started my first real job at AED. Chad showed me around, I was basically under Chad, and he showed my responsibilities, and he instantly earned my respect for his work ethic and how much people loved him and how he interacted with people. And I think to this day, that has really, it's basically ingrained into my work ethic, and I owe that basically to Chad. Chad had this one ability of, didn't matter who you were, he made you feel like you were his friend, one of his best friends, regardless of how long he knew you. He could always find something to bond with anybody. And because of that, everybody loved him. I bonded with Chad over our love for movies and TV shows and a little bit of trivia, although my trivia skills are nowhere close to Chad's, but he was always there and always in the back of my mind anytime I saw any show, and I couldn't wait to discuss it with him. I also saw Chad and Anne as friends, and as their friendship blossomed into their, I think Chad and Anne were probably one of the few couples that I knew that I could truly call them as soulmates. And so Chad's passing, I'm sorry, I'm struggling with words, but he is truly, truly going to be missed. And to everybody who's known him and loved him, I feel your loss, as I feel that he will be truly missed.
Thank you, Asif. Shante, are there any more?
No, not at this time.
Okay, this brings us to the point of the service where we ask Anne, Angie, and Nil to say a few items, and then we will have a closing song from Sarah Del Villano.
I suppose
Neil's going to go first, or Angie.
I'll go first, then my sister. It's good to see a bunch of AED folks. I too started at AED. I guess I could kind of consider it my first real job too. And of course, from there, my brother joined me at AED. I work in HR, so I was able to get my brother in after he graduated. So I too have an AED connection. My brother's voice is still the greeting voice at my parents' home phone. And although my mom complains about how she can't hear from that phone, she said she doesn't want to change it because she won't hear Chad's voice, because that is the voice. So forever it will be that way. Say, in my phone, I have saved all the messages. And when Chad passed away, I didn't want to lose something. I save all the messages that he's left in my phone. And even days after he passed away, sometimes I would leave a message on his phone when I'm walking my dog. It is hard for me, for Neil and for Anne, to sometimes believe this is real. Really, I am supposed to be drinking in Anne and Chad's house or some park, getting drunk right now, celebrating his birthday. That is what I'm supposed to do right now. I'm supposed to be drunk, celebrating my brother's 50th birthday. Sorry, Mom, I know you're in line. But that's not it. But I will drink later on, I'm sure, but it's only because I need to drown my sorrow. Thank you for being here for us. It will not be easy. We miss Chad, but hearing how wonderful he's affected your lives helps us go through this. Never forget. I know that there's always a part of him in all my children. For those of you who have met my children, there is a part of Chad in every single one of them. From my game-loving Diana, witty and a great writer, to my smart Tony, who doesn't study as much. For those of you who have been with Chad, he really doesn't study as much, but he can do it. And that is Tony. To my social butterfly, Gabby, who's just like Chad. So he is in every one of my child, and they love him so much. Thank you for being with us and for joining us today. Benny, floor is yours, dear.
Hi, I just want to thank everyone. Don't really have much words, but I will be, I want to do in Anne's request, Walt Whitman's Oh Captain, My Captain. Also, this is from one of Chad's favorite movies, Dead Poets Society. Oh Captain, My Captain, our fearful trip is done. The ship has weathered every rack. The prize we sought is won. The port is near, the bells I hear, the people all exulting. While follow eyes the steady keel, the vessel grim and daring. But oh heart, oh the bleeding drops of red, where on the deck my captain lies, fallen cold and dead. Just think of Robin Williams and Dead Poets Society. Chad loved that scene. I miss him dearly.
I want to thank you all again for joining us in this tribute to Chad's life. I think he would have loved it. Maybe needed more music. I want to give special thanks to Glenn Strong and to Shantae Geigen for coordinating the Zoom meeting. And Shantae has never met me or Chad and is doing this on her own time. So I really, really appreciate this. This is so generous of you. Thank you. So I have a couple of words, so bear with me. This is longer than I had anticipated. We lost Chad to COVID-19. I had hoped to be celebrating his 50th birthday today. Sorry, I'm gonna go down a road I wasn't sure I wanted to go down. I know in my heart that if this pandemic had been managed by a responsible, competent, caring government, Chad might be alive today. If we had been in lockdown 3 weeks earlier in mid-February, perhaps we could have been celebrating his birthday with him in person now. I used to get up, you know, regularly around 6:30, 7 a.m. Now I have trouble getting out of bed before 10 a.m. I lie there and I can't get up. The joy in my life has been taken from me. I can't yet see a purpose to living without Chad. But I have heard some words of comfort, empathy, and guidance from one person in our political leadership. When asked what he would say to people who have lost loved ones to COVID-19, Joe Biden, who lost a wife, daughter, and son to cancer, responded this way. And please listen, because I think this is beautiful and this is helping me. He said, "The folks who have lost a loved one," he said to the folks who have lost a loved one to COVID-19, "they feel like there is a blank hole in the middle of their chest. They are being sucked into it. And they are frightened and they are scared and they don't know what to do. All I can tell them is that it will take time. But in time, what is going to happen is that you're going to find that when you think of that son, daughter, husband, wife, mother, father that you lost, you're going to get a smile on your lips before you get a tear in your eye. And that's when you know you're going to make it. And the way you make it, at least in my experience, is that you have to have a purpose. Purpose will drive you to be able to control your life. And the purpose will be, for many of these people, what do we do to make life better for other people? How could we have avoided what happened here? What are the things you want to do? The time will come when you'll get through this veil of darkness. But the best way to do it is with a sense of purpose. And you've got to move. You've got to get up. Just get up." In honor of Chad, who I know would agree with me, I hope you join me in finding a purpose to help this broken society we have now in also many ways. I'm still looking for a purpose to get me through this. If you have suggestions, I'd love to talk again. Thank you.
Thank you, Anne, Angie, and Neil. We'll now have the closing song by, I didn't even notice that Anne told me how to pronounce this, Del Villano, who's a friend and a trivia teammate of Chad's.
Good afternoon, everybody. When Anne and I talked about what song I should sing for the memorial, we tossed out many ideas, and some of them were funny, and most were heartfelt and appropriate. But when we landed on "You Will Never Walk Alone," we knew that we had chosen the right song. Chad absolutely loved musical theater. We shared that passion, and this song was written by Rodgers and Hammerstein for the musical Carousel. In the musical, the lead male, he dies, and this song is sung to his widow by someone who loved her. As a reminder that for those of us who are left behind, that we're never alone, and that has been proven by this beautiful memorial that that Anne has put together for us. The song has a second meaning. It was adopted by the Liverpool Football Club. And if anyone knows, Chad was a huge, huge fan of Liverpool football. They would often go into DC to find a bar that would be showing a game to watch. And the fans of Liverpool, before every home game, get together and they sing this beautiful, beautiful song from Carousel. We're hoping that you'll sing along with us. We invite you to sing as our tribute to Chad in the tradition of Liverpool football. Thank you.
And don't be
Thank you.
That is the end of today's service for Chad and all the memories we have of Chad. What we're going to try to do over the next 15 minutes is just Shantae will put people into the group. People can talk as you see people. You can say whatever you want to say. It'll be a mishmash. But that ends the formal ceremony. And thank you everyone for showing up. You guys can go off mute now and you could just talk.
Thanks, Glenn.
Juan, that was an amazing speech.
Hey, thanks, Glenn. You know, I was telling Ann earlier this week that Chad just makes it easy. You know, it's you don't have to struggle to find the words or to find the stories of so many lives that he's touched and so many positive qualities about him. If anything, he makes it hard because there are so many stories and there are so many people and there just are so many wonderful things to say about him. So he kind of makes it hard and he makes it easy at the same time.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And how are you feeling? I love your shirt, Ann.
I should have changed into this a little sooner, I think, right? I had a whole costuming going on. I had forgotten to thank all of you who spoke as well and sang. What a tribute to Chad that there's so many wonderful people in his life. It's stunning when I think about it.
We have two participants out there who want to talk to us. So Shantae, can you get them in?
Yep, I'm working on that.
Oh, Jamie!
Hi, y'all. How's it going?
Hey, Jamie. One of the guys. The guy that abandoned Ashley.
Not true. Never happened. Never happened.
Hey, the dog.
Hey, Jamie.
Hey, how are you?
Well, That's
kind of a stupid question, and I'm sorry about that.
I have great memories of you guys crashing my parties. That's for sure.
Well, as do I. It was funny. Ashley was talking, and I wish my brain worked like that. I don't remember specific things. It's just not the way my mind works. My wife teases me about it all the time. It's just I remember. I don't know. I just remember feelings and times and you know Chad's house and your place and Chad's basement are the best, you know, the best memories I have of when I was younger. And it's that will never leave, but it's, you know, it's very special memories for me as far as my head works. Just the feeling of being there and you and your sister and Chad's family, always letting us goofballs come and crash in your basement until all hours. It was just great. Just great.
Yep. Yep. Sorry for contributing.
I remember you, Jamie, from the AD softball games.
I remember those games. It was a lot of fun.
Yeah. I remember the crashing party, and someone actually cut a hole in the rug because of a cigarette burn.
Well, that wasn't me.
I know. But I remember Chad cutting it, and he's like, oh, we'll just put a rug over it. And we did. And sorry, Mom, if you heard it. Yeah, there was actually a hole in that rug. That's why there's a carpet.
The Capule residents and the Wishaw residents took a lot of wear and tear from the guys.
Why didn't we do that at Wishaw's place?
Yeah. You brought in the stop sign at Wishaw's place.
What's this we?
Ashley brought in the stop
sign. It's fair enough.
No, someone ate my mom's chunky monkey ice cream and no one's ever invited back to my place after that. I think it was Cyril.
Yeah, I heard you guys were trying to look for Cyril, so. Yep. Was this recorded, by the way?
What?
Was this service recorded?
Totally. Yes, it's recorded.
Yeah, okay, good.
It's still recording.
Oh, no. Let's take this part out. My fault. Our